It's loading. I believe
it's loading.
All right, so we are live in the page now, and we're going to let people know that we're getting started. Welcome, and we're a little early today because we wanted to make sure that everybody found us. There were no problems, so we're a little early today, and we welcome you in. We're already set and ready to give you guys some great, great, great bread, some good bread, some good eats. So come on in. I see, oh, people are already coming in. Bless the name of the Lord. We're already live in the Miriam's Mission page. If you can, go ahead and share and like this page. Let people know that we are going forth right now, getting ready for class 4. We started just a little early. We want to welcome people. So we're going to let people come in. And we just want to say hello and welcome to the last class of Prepare for End Time Movement. This is class 4. Highways, byways, and beyond. God bless you. We have some awesome people with us today, and we're looking forward to being a blessing to you. We want to be enriched. We're going to glean from one another. It is going to be an awesome thing. I see you guys coming on in. I'm excited. Let's see if I can see who's on. God bless you guys. All right. Hallelujah. Hey, Evangelist Jean. How are you, Delia? God bless you. Hey, Anika from South America. I see you guys coming in. I've seen some of you all decrees. It's good to see you from Georgetown. God bless you guys. Come on in. Hey, Deja. I see my Miriam's Mission administrators. God bless you guys. Come on in. We're going to get some music going because we want to encourage everybody that God is getting ready to just set it off on this last class. He is going to bless our souls today. He's going to remind us why we go, how we go, being sent, and where we're going. Hallelujah. We're going to get prepared for end time movement. This last class is about to kick off. So tell your friends. Hallelujah. I see Pastor Walter. What's going on? God bless you, bro. Hey, Kimberly from South America. I see you guys. Kimberly Fleming. Come on in, you guys. We are going to have a good time. We're getting ready to get started. I'm just going to play a little music. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to have a little music to stir our souls. Hallelujah. Hey, everybody, come on in. Denisa, God bless you. Woo! Let's go. Let's get geared up. I see you guys. Come on in. All right. Natasha Garcia, oh my, your decree was amazing. Outside over the business in Riverview, Florida. You blessed my soul. Natasha, come on in, you guys. Hello. Woo. Hallelujah. Can you all hear the music?
Haven't seen you in a while.
Woo. Hey, hello, world.
My name is Daniel.
We're coming in and we're coming hard and strong today. Welcome.
My name is Bethany.
Marion Adridge in Georgetown, Guyana. Hallelujah. Melissa in Tampa, Florida.
Woo. Like you to meet.
Bless you. I see you guys coming in. LaShondra Carson, Chicago. Come on in.
I'd like to introduce to you.
Come on, come on. We got some good ease today. Apostle Sharon Peters Ruff is with us, you guys. Minister Jeanette Chestnut Chester is with us. Come on in, you guys.
You're looking fine.
Woo. Phyllis in Arkansas. I see you. God bless you. Woo. All right, we're a little early. I know we're early. Don't worry, you haven't missed anything. Come on in. Woo. Woo. Hey. Woo. Hallelujah. Yes. Hey. Yes. Hello. A little early today, but come on in. Hey, Kina. Hey, Fanita. Pastor Fanita. God bless you.
God bless you. Come on in. Hey, OJ Roberts. Oh my. You guys are doing it down there in Guyana. God bless you. Come on in. Hey, beloved Jennifer, my friend. Chicago's in the house. Woo. I see you, Darlene from Florida. God bless you. Come on in. Hallelujah. Hey, Chastity in Ohio. Come on, Cincinnati. Listen, I pray you're getting some rest. I pray you're getting some rest. God bless you. Welcome for the first time, Teresa Cooks. We're thankful that you joined us today. This is a great day to join. God bless you. Hallelujah. We started a little early today, everybody, so don't you worry. You haven't missed a thing. We wanted to make sure that we were getting people in, so I know that we're going to start seeing quite a few more. Hallelujah. Hey, Tammy from Salem, Tammy Chambers, Tammy Hutchinson. You guys, oh, y'all coming in. Y'all said, we're not going to miss this. We don't want you to miss anything. Come on, church. Come on. We're keeping Jesus in the midst. Come on, church. Hallelujah. We're leaving the walls so that we can release all that we've been gleaning and all that we've been taking in. Woo. Yes. Come on in. Hey, Marsha Lowry. God bless you. Come on in. Crystal, I see you. Woo. Oh, man, I'm excited. Man, the class, you guys from Cicero, Illinois, from Karan Nolan, from Hazelcrest, hallelujah. Taurus Porter in Streamwood, Shirley Mills Dower in Maryland, God bless you. You were our first, the person who finished homework first last week. I'm so blessed that you were able to do a decree for us too, Shirley, all the way from Maryland. God bless you. I know we have Jennifer from Chicago on the line, Chantrell Hopes from Mississippi. You guys have been such an extraordinary team, an extraordinary group of people who are open to learn and grow, and you're going to grow even the more on today. We have some phenomenal women of God here on the line. It is 7 o'clock officially, so we're going to probably see a lot of popping on right now, but we're going to just kind of get a little bit into our introduction of the panel. Hallelujah. I am grateful to God to have my right hand and the person who has been the longest standing member of Miriam's Mission. She's been with me probably a little over 10 years. I think, yes, longer. I'm not sure. But I'm excited that Minister Jeanette is with us today. Mama Jeanette, we call her Mother Jeanette. She's a Miriam's mother, and she is going to be working with us. Hey, Deborah. Hey, Jillian from Georgetown. You guys are in here strong today. Hey, Elaine. God bless you. God bless you, Pastor Lisa. So we also have the distinct honor of having with us, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about who she is right before she speaks, but we are truly, truly blessed to have a strong Mother of Zion here on the line, an apostolic voice, a true trailblazer, a woman of God that has nurtured a number of different voices here in Chicago and abroad. And we have someone who is going to talk from in-depth experience of going and being a sent one and one that sends. So we have with us, God bless you, Apostle Sharon Peters Ruff. God bless you. I'm so glad that she is here on the line with us today. And you guys are going to hear from her, Elder Staples. God bless you. That's right, Walter. I know that's your apostle. She is a Zion mother, I'm telling you. And we're excited to have her here. And so I see you, Stacy, Melissa, God bless you guys. We want to just do a quick recap from last week. Last week's class was extraordinary. We dealt with the glory of God and learning how to govern by the glory of God. We talked about what kingdom government is. We talked about the priestly, prophetic, and kingly dimensions that Jesus moved in, that we are to also move in. We talked about becoming citizens that are more than just the church that is relational or oikos church. We talked about becoming the ecclesia or the governing arm of Christ Jesus. We want to learn to move in the authority and the government. That is something that we have not always taught. And I tell you tonight, we're going to get more of that today. We want to learn to move outside of just being relational and the family of God, but becoming the governmental authority of God. So we talked about that glory. We talked about the weight of God's glory. We talked about even learning to use decrees that are immovable, written, established word of God that cause his edicts from heaven to enter into the earth. So on this day, last week, we really wanted to dig deep into understanding how to be governors of the glory of God. I am so excited that you have joined back today, and some of you all had some homework that was phenomenal. It was phenomenal. It was allowing us to actually apply and put to work the concepts that we learned last week. We also talked in depthly about the intercession and the worship that opens the gate for the glory of God to enter into the earth, and how we as intercessors and as worshipers carry the ability to climb and ascend into realms that will establish what is in heaven here on the earth. So we talked about the importance of intercession, how important it is to come into the secret place. We talked so much about the understanding of mountains and the things that God establishes at the top of his mountains. So we had some awesome insight on homework. And I want to mention this week, and I believe she's on the line. I see those numbers popping up. Margaret Easton, Angela, Florine, I see you guys on. Yes, Darlene, you are on here from Riverview, Florida. Darlene, glory to God, was the first person to turn in homework this week. So you guys give it up. Darlene is going to be blessed because she was that first person to turn in homework this week. Glory to God. And so I'm excited because, and I want to let Libby swoop. I see you on the line. We did receive your week 2 homework. I want to talk about some of the creativity you guys extended during the homework. One of the public decrees that we received was actually someone doing a baptism in the backyard of a 6-year-old who has been battling cancer. This 6-year-old has been battling brain cancer and requested to be saved and baptized. The church at the time is not able to allow persons in and was not able, but this particular person, this member of the class, was able to go to the backyard in a pool and to begin to decree salvation has come to this baby. That was a decree that mutes out every other decree. So that decree, when we saw that child being baptized, and you can find that decree and that video on my page, it is on my page, you will see a child who is battling and is going to overcome. Come on, because we're going to pray. We're going to believe God that he will send his word and he will heal Aaliyah swiftly of that brain cancer. It is no longer hers because the Lordship of Jesus Christ is standing up in that child today. We decree it. And so she was baptized, and that was one of the homework assignments. And that person actually used that assignment and just said, you know what, I didn't get a chance to do that assignment on video, but because she recorded that baptism, we definitely say that was a decree from the Lord. Hallelujah. I want to also mention someone who actually took the time to share what their midnight pause, their midnight time in the secret place, their time of seeking God, produced some really strong, heartfelt, glory to glory, transforming prayer for their community. Deborah Cody was one of the few people that actually typed and sent what she journaled in her time of midnight intercession. She spent time praying for her block. And as she was praying and weeping and travailing for her community, the Lord began to have her pray for the block connected to her block, and then the block after that and the community. So God took her from glory to glory, from realm to realm, and from area and region to region. She became a governor of the glory of God as she was in intercession. And the Lord began to show her it's not just your block that needs the mediation, but it was the block connected and the block after that. So thank God for Deborah sharing that with us. I want to say thank you to Shirley Dower, Natasha Garcia, Fanita Gamble, Angela Witherspoon, Kathy Wright, Kelsey and 1J, Kelsey Carter and 1J Roberts, who did public decrees and hashtag glory to, governing by glory. You guys can see those decrees on the Miriam's Mission page. Glory to God. I also want to talk about some of the, I believe Tina Velasquez, she gave some really honest, open heart check things that she received in her midnight time in secret prayer. I was thankful that she shared with us that God was dealing with her in some honesty and some heart evaluation. Remember, this is where we began. This is where we started in class one. The compass of Christ was all about having his heart and also doing a heart evaluation. Before you go, you need to check your heart, your motives, your intents, and make sure that they are lining up with the heart and the motive and intents of Christ Jesus. So thank you, Tina, for sharing that. I love that there was some persons that shared that Judah or praise is a weapon that we have that gives us a governing ability. And I love that they used one of the examples was that Jesus is to be praised for his reconciliation of us back to the Father. And that in and of itself, his reconciling, his laying his life down on the cross is the weapon that gives us the ability to govern here on the earth on behalf of the Lord. So I'm really, really grateful that we are able to kind of talk a little bit about some of those awesome assignments. A lot of the assignments came in after five, so I didn't get a chance to review and make note of all of them, but we are going to be giving some feedback. If you want feedback on all of your homework assignments, you can simply inbox me or email me and I will send back some things, some notes that we took concerning your mappings, concerning your prayer strategies. But I just want to tell you, thank you for all of the persons that took the time to actually dig into the word. Remember, the homework isn't for me. It isn't for Miriam's Mission. The homework is to actually cause you to apply the things that you are learning and to actually put them into action. So I'm thankful for that. I want to talk about something before we move into our class. It is 7:09, and so we're doing really good in our time. I want to start talking a little bit about highways, byways, and beyond, and then I'm going to bring in our guest speakers. I believe, are you guys all right? Just tell me if you're all right. Just say, we're all right.
We're good.
Glory to God. I want to tell you that today's class is to help us get an understanding of the innovative creativity that is needed in our going. In our going, we must be able to birth heavenly activity here and transformation here on the earth. So our creativity and our innovation in this specific time, especially in this time that we're in, we're going to have to seek the heart of God and hear from the Spirit of the Lord to know where and when and how to move, to take the good news of Jesus Christ. We've learned a lot over the past 3 weeks, but tonight we're gonna go into the highways, the byways, and beyond. The Bible tells us in Acts chapter 1 that when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will be witnesses. The Bible says, and it records that you'll be a witness in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria. He is talking about, and even to the ends of the world. God is desiring us to be witnesses, eyewitnesses, those that can give account and those that can stand up and speak on behalf of the Lord Jesus Christ. We can point to his greatness. We can point to his goodness. We can point to his ability to provide. We can point to his ability to heal. We must be those witnesses in the earth. And it starts with Jerusalem. And over the course of the last 3 weeks, we've talked a lot about Jerusalem. That is the place that we consider home. It's a type of shadow of the church and your home. So we've talked about doing a heart check, checking you. And then we talked about mapping your own home and making sure things are in order in your house. How dare we go out and share the good news and there are people living in your home that do not know the Lord Jesus Christ because they've never heard you or they've never seen you demonstrate and be a witness of Jesus. So we understand that Jerusalem is where we're supposed to start, but God wants to take us to Judea. Glory to God. Judea is the community. That is your community. That's your block. That is the area that you live in. That is the city, the village, the region in which you reside. There are some things that have to be adjusted and governed in that region, and that you have been sent as a kingdom regent, glory to God, to regulate, hallelujah, to govern by the glory of God. So we're going to talk about those kind of things, and we're going to talk about going to Samaria, the northernmost part historically of Jerusalem, but we're going to talk about going to the places that nobody really wants to go. See, Samaria wasn't so flashy and wasn't so beautiful, but it was a place that a lot of people thought very low of. Hallelujah. We're going to talk today about going to Samaria, and then how so many of us get excited about going to the uttermost parts of the earth, going to the nations. Oh, I'm going to the nations. But are we ready to really govern? Are we really ready to step on a foreign land and to operate as a regent in that land, as one of God's kingdom witnesses? Are we ready? Well, we're going to talk about when we go, how we go. So I want to give something real quick. I want us to remember Revelations 11 and 15 says, the seventh angel sounded his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven, which said, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and his Messiah, and he will reign forever. God is wanting the kingdom of the world to be turned into the kingdom of our Lord. And we are those that are have been placed here as his glory carriers, as his representatives, as his witnesses, to begin to turn the land. We are literally upon our feet. We carry the tilling ability. Come on, somebody. Just like you have that machine that goes and plows the land, your feet are to plow this land. Glory to God. Your feet are to carry the good news. It is to preach the gospel. Yes. It is to speak our God reigns. Come on, somebody. You are the one that's going to turn this land into the kingdom of God. So I want to talk a little bit about what a highway, a byway, and beyond is. The Bible, the dictionary says that a highway is a public and a private road, but it's a major road. It is a major transitional place, and it is public, a way that connects cities and towns. And it's a practical, useful source for public transportation. It is a way to move things. And as we think about it, it normally consists of heavy traffic, a highway, because there's a lot of motion there. Now, I want you to liken a highway in the spirit as a public sector or a place that people are normally moving the good news. Are you hearing me? The highway we're going to liken for this teaching into a place where the good news is normally going and there's a lot of traffic. Yes, that's the church, and that's sometimes our families. That's the normal places where you hear people talking about Jesus Christ. The church, in the church, around the church, on Facebook Live, when we're preaching and teaching, that is a highway. And you know what? It gets clogged up. Are you with me? There are times where Facebook is clogged up. It's a clogged up expressway. Everybody's preaching. Everybody's teaching. Everybody's prophesying. Some people are prophesying. We have a lot of traffic on the highway. But we want to talk about going to the byways. Now, a byway, by Webster's Dictionary, is a road or a place that is not a main route. It is not. It's a minor road, and it's a path. It is a little known area, and it doesn't have a lot of detail. It's often rural, and it's often unsurfaced. That means there's not a lot of pavement, and people aren't traveling it often. Woo! It typically has the appearance of like green lanes. It doesn't look as finished with all the pretty on and off exit routes and all these things. A byway is not the norm. And I want to liken today the byway being something like a system that we haven't stepped into, the corporate and business system, the education system, governmental sectors. These are places that the gospel has not traveled that often.
Yes.
It's uncharted territory. Are you with me, people? Just tell me if you're with me. Oh, I see my spiritual mother, Pastor Barb. God bless you. If you understand that the byway has not been traveled often, just put in there, it's time to go to the byways. It's time to go to the byways. Type it in. It's time to go to the byways. Now, I want to talk a little bit about to Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth. Many people are going to liken Samaria is that place that nobody wants to go. It's that place that people think nobody's going to hear. Nobody's going to listen. Nobody wants the good news. I want you to liken, just for this teaching, media and arts and entertainment as Samaria. It's the place where there's a lot of stuff going on and people don't want to take the good news. Why? You can't talk about Jesus Christ in Hollywood. You can't talk about Jesus Christ in the music industry. You can't talk about Jesus Christ in arts. But we're going to liken, come on somebody, Samaria as arts and entertainment and media. Hallelujah. We can't share the good news in these sectors, but it's time, you all that are on this line, to prepare for end time movement. It's time to move into Samaria with the good news. Come on, there's some people in here who are actors. There are some people who have the songs. There are some people who know how to model. There's some people that know how to draw, who know how to design clothing, and they need to go to Samaria with the good news. Glory to God. And we're going to talk about the uttermost parts of the earth. That is crossing over the waters into lands you have never been to before. That is going into nations. So those are my friends that are on the line here from Guyana, from Georgetown, Guyana, and South America. We're talking about you coming over here and us going into South America. It's us leaving the United States and going into Europe and going into Africa and going into Asia, going to the uttermost parts of the earth. That is beyond where we are. That is your feet carrying the glory of God into a place that you have not gone before. God wants us to do this in a creative and an innovative way. Are you with me, people of God? I'm going to tell you what innovation is. Innovation is a new method. It's a new product. It's a new idea. And creativity, yes, is the imagination or the original ideas of an artistic work. It's inventiveness. It's inspiration. It is vision. It is resourcefulness, and it's initiative. Come on, write it, type it in there. It's initiative. Yes, God. It's taking the initiative to go.
That's right. That's right.
By the Bible standards, there is nothing in the Bible that talks about creativity that is not attached to God's ability to do the miraculous. Do you hear what I'm saying?
Yes, yes.
If you say that you're creative, there should be supernatural miracles that follow you. And I'm talking out of the Bible. The word tells us, many people in the world says that a child's scribble is creative and Einstein's theory of relativity is creative. But the Hebrew word for creativity is bara, B-A-R-A. This speaks to God's achievements. It is him creating the heavens and the earth. Come on, somebody. That's beyond drawing something nice. That's beyond dancing or
singing.
That's right. Bara is his ability to create righteousness and justice, to create the church, to build regeneration and to worship. God's bara creativity
is
supernatural. In the Bible, creativity always includes the miraculous and the mysterious.
Mm-hmm.
Exodus 34 and 10 says, listen, I am making a covenant with you in the presence of all your people. I will perform, that word perform is bara, miracles that have never been done, that is also bara, anywhere in the earth or in any nation. God is saying, I'm going to create something, I'm going to do something, I'm going to create and move in a way no one has ever seen before. That's creativity. Hallelujah. And all the people around you will see the power of the Lord, the awesome power I display for you. So if we're going to move in innovative ways to bring the good news to a dying world, God said you're going to have to let him create it. You're going to have to let him work this supernatural work.
Yes.
All the people around will see when you are doing it with borrowed creativity, everyone around you, corporate, businesses, government, come on, education, arts and media, they will see the power of God. Are you with me?
Amen. Hallelujah.
There is a study of 86 occurrences in the word create in the scripture. Bara, newness, is the first of its kind. When you do it, it's the first. When you do whatever God has called you to, it's the first time he's called you to it, and it's the first time he's loosing it in the earth. It did not exist before. Isaiah 43 verses 15 through 21. Behold, I do a new thing. Come on. When God says I do a new thing,
can
he is bara creativity. Bara newness
Lord.
Is humanly unforeseeable. That means it's something that you as a flesh being cannot do. When you have the innovation and the creativity of God to go with the good news, that true bara newness, it's humanly unforeseeable. It has the quality of surprise and it brings hiddenness to light. Are you with me? It has the quality of the unpredictable and the unexpected. I didn't expect that to happen. I didn't know that was going to happen. When I obeyed the word of the Lord, when I listened to what he told me to do, when I went where he told me to go.
Jesus.
Apostle Peter is going to tell you about when she followed the word of the Lord, there were some things that happened that were unexpected and unexplainable. Glory to God. Because bara newness is human unforeseeable. Bara newness is valuable. So when we take the good news into places that we have never gone before, using formats we've never used before, it is not something that we do for novelty's sake. It's something that has value. So it must solve a problem. It's gonna serve a function. It's gonna be workable. Come on, it's gonna be a solution here at Cornerstone Christian Center. We call ourselves solutionists. Listen, I got some bara creativity in me, some newness that causes solutions to come. Glory to God. Isaiah 41, 17 through 20, he will do a miraculous work that provides solutions so that we know he is the creator of all the heavens and the universe.
Yes.
In that scripture, he's talking about desert places. He's talking about drought. He's talking about parched lands. And he's talking about, I'm going to bring a spring in that parched land. I'm going to put rivers in high places. Come on, in this scripture, Isaiah 41, he's saying you're going to see rivers in plateaus in the mountains. You're going to see rivers that are fed by springs in high places. You're going to see water where there's no water. Come on, you all. God said it's going to be valuable because where there's drought, there's a need for water. So that brings a solution. So if you want to carry the good news and you want to do the work of Jesus Christ, you're going to have to do it with a bara newness that brings solutions. I don't want you just going to Lower Wacker in Chicago, providing some meals so that you can show some pictures on Facebook. What is the solution to the homelessness on Lower Wacker? What is the solution to the lack of these mothers being able to take care of their children? We are going to have a new innovative format that will bring solution, that will bring provision. Are you with me, people of God? Newness that causes solutions. That's right, Kina. Come on, somebody. The last thing we're going to say is that bara kitso newness. In the Greek, newness or creativity is kitso. It is transformational. When we are doing something in an innovative and creative way by the Spirit of God, it is transformational. It can become a part of things that we do, yet it's always transforming and recreating. Galatians 6 and 15 says that nothing really matters outside of being transformed into a new creature. Galatians 6 and 15 tells us I don't care about anything unless you're being made into a new creature. God is interested in transformation. He wants you to be transformed into the image of his son from glory to glory. Come on, getting his mind, hallelujah, having his heart, hallelujah, moving the way he moved, stepping the way he stepped, dancing the way he danced, singing how he sings. Come on, governing the way Jesus governed. He wants you to be transformed. Ephesians 2 and 15, Christ brings peace by creating one new people from two different groups. God said, I'm about to bring the Jew and the Gentile together, and I'm going to create my people. I'm all about transformation. So if I'm going to do something new in the earth, I'm about transforming people. Bara newness is all about creating something new. Glory
Amen.
To the name
Glory
of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're coming to the end of this section. I wanted just to talk quickly about being innovative, and then I'm going to bring in how you must move from innovation into taking the truth from the altar to the alley. So in order for us to go, we must also mirror the creative people that God placed in the Bible. He gave us some people to look at. If you want to see how do I take the gospel? Where do I take it? In fact, I see you on the line. I see some of you on the line already. Well, I'm not a creative. I'm not a singer. I don't draw. I don't write. Oh, I see you on the line. I see you on the line. That is not what we're talking about, just those that are artistic. We are talking about those who will fall into the shadow of God. Let me explain to you. Exodus 31, verses 1 through 11, speaks of someone named Bezalel. Bezalel was the person who was given the design of the tabernacle. This is where all of the worship took place. Bezalel came and was given inspiration by the Father to build the place where he will inhabit, the place where his presence would reside, the place where the people would come to worship the Almighty God. Now let's take a look at Bezalel. His name is Bezalel, and his name actually means in the shadow of God, under the protection of God. So if you're going to be innovative in how you go and where you go, you must be in the shadow of God and under the protection of God. Are you with me, people of God? See, let's look in the scriptures and then we're going to pass it on.
Amen.
Exodus 31, verse 2. Bezalel was called by name and he was of the tribe of Judah. Look at that, y'all. We talked about Judah last week. Bezalel, whose name means in the shadow of God, was called and invited by God, and he was a worshiper. He was from the tribe of Judah. He couldn't help himself. He had to be. He was the lineage of a worshiper was in him. He was a praiser. He had to lift up his hands. He had to give thanks. So while he was building the tabernacle, while he was creating a place for the presence of the Lord to reside, he was always in praise. So as you're getting ready to move, as you're getting ready to go from the highways to the byways and beyond, you best believe you're going to need to have a praise in your blood. You're going to need to have a praise
Amen.
So that you can stay in the shadow of God and you can stay under the protection
yes.
of God. Verse 3 says, I have filled him with the Spirit of God. So Bezalel and you have to be inspired and filled with the Holy Ghost, filled with the breath
yes.
of God, filled with his character, wisdom, knowledge, might, understanding, come on, the fear of the Lord. Come on, somebody. Bezalel was filled with the Holy Spirit. Woo, Jesus. Verse 6, Bezalel said, and in the hearts of all that are wise hearted. That means their hearts were open to the wisdom of God. That means in your going, your heart has to be open to the wisdom of God, not what you're used to doing, not
yes.
what your aunt used to do, not mm-hmm. even what you've seen other people do. See, you're going to have your heart open so that when God says go, when God says speak, when God says give, when God says trust, your heart will be open to his wisdom so that you can create and you can
yes,
do whatever Lord. He's told you to do.
Yes, Jesus.
Verse 6. I love this. And then we're going to be wrapping up a little bit about the highways and byways. Verse 6 says, I have given him Oholiab, This is so interesting. Bezalel didn't build the temple by himself. He was the one that was called, but God said, I gave him some help. Willing to work in unity with someone else is necessary to create and to birth in the earth what's in heaven. Come on, someone. You must be able to work on a team. Ooh, and I know Apostle Peter is going to hit this. You must be willing to co-join with people. Hallelujah. And to be one. See, Bezalel worked with one type of linen and fine fabric. And Oholiab worked with metals and stones in building the tabernacle. Glory to God. One worked with hard items and the other worked with soft items. They were demonstrating that everyone's going to have different gifts. But in order to birth something new in the earth, you got to co-join, you got to unify, you got to get connected and stay under the shadow of God and under the protection of him. Be careful, all of you who are ready to go. Be careful that you don't get prideful and thinking, I got some information. I took this class, prepare for end time movement, and I did my homework, and I heard Apostle Peters, and I heard Elder Jacqueline and Pastor Lisa and Jeanette and all these people, and I'm ready to go. See, perversion can enter in at any time into your heart. So you have to guard your heart with God, with due diligence. Guard your heart you're preparing to go. When God starts to drop wisdom on you, when he starts to give you some innovative ideas, you got to prepare your heart so that you don't become one like Lucifer, who was filled with a multitude of merchandise. Yes. You got so much going for you. You got so many gifts. You got so many ideas. God. You got so much going. You think that you all that in a bag of chips. You think that you got it going on. You can go anywhere and do anything and say anything, and the lost are going to come, and people are going to say, well, thank you so much for saving us and blessing us. God said, be careful that you don't fall into perversion through pride because of the multitude of merchandise. Ezekiel 28 says, by the multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence. Lucifer was filled with violence because he was so full of creative ability. He lost sight of who gave it to him. You all are filled, and we're going to be filled with the Spirit of God so that we can go. We need to go with the heart of Christ, and we need to go with truth. At this time, I want to share with you and invite Minister Jeanette to share with us how we're going to carry that truth from the altar to the alley, and how important it is, God's word is, and how important our sacrifices are in order for us to go effectively. And we're going to have Minister Jeanette go, and she's going to speak for 15 minutes, and then we're going to bring up Apostle Sharon Peters, who's going to tell us it's time, let's go. All right, God bless you guys.
Amen.
Minister Jeanette, if you'll come forth, God bless you. Are you on, Jeanette?
Amen.
Can't hear you.
I'm here. Can you hear me? You can't hear me?
Yes.
Apostle, okay. Can you hear?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. There you are.
Yeah, my screen is still freezing. My screen is still freezing. So I'm going to just keep talking hope that even when it freezes, I hope it'll keep going and you can still hear me.
Amen.
Okay. So as Elder Jackie was speaking about that abundance of merchandise that was in Lucifer, we have to remember that we also carry merchandise, and some of this merchandise that we carry, we have to take it to the altar and sacrifice it. So you might ask, what is an altar? What is the purpose of an altar? An altar is a structure. It is a structure upon which offerings such as sacrifices are made for religious purposes. It was usually a raised platform on a flat surface. There were over 400 references to altars in the Bible. And something stood out to me as I was reading and studying about altars. Sometimes we get altars, A-L-T-A-R, confused with the word altar, A-L-T-E-R. Those are two different things. When we take what we hold dear and what we think that we have use of, and we lay it on the altar, A-L-T-A-R, God alters, A-L-T-E-R. He alters it. and makes us useful. He makes us meet. He makes us able to carry what it is he desires for us to carry, because we have emptied ourselves of those things that we thought were useful for us. Hallelujah. There's a kingdom work that needs to be done. The very first altar that was made by Noah. And you'll see that in Genesis chapter 8. After Noah was obedient, he was obedient to the word of God, even in the midst of everything that was going on when people thought he was crazy. A lot of times when we are laying things down at the altar, when we are preparing to go out into the byways and to the highways and the byways, we have to be renewed. And so often we go and we ask, oh Lord, fill me up, but there's no room for him to fill us up when we haven't emptied ourselves of what we've been carrying around. So in order for us to do that, we have to go and lay those things down. I'm sorry, we lay them down at the altar of sacrifice so that God can burn it up. He burns it up. He burns it up, and then he gives us what we need in order to be meat that is useful for his table. So when we talk about how does the altar affect the work of the kingdom, we go back and look at, we can look at Psalms 51. We want to know if, is our sacrifice at the altar, is it sufficient? When King David did some very bad things, he wanted to make a sacrifice unto the Lord. He didn't want his sacrifice to be a meaningless sacrifice. He asked the Lord to create in him a clean heart. And so often we do that. So often we ask the Lord to create in us a clean heart, but we never acknowledge the stuff that's in our heart. I think the very first lesson that Elder Jackie talked about was the heart. We never acknowledge what we've been carrying around in our heart. We have to lay those things, our heart desires, before the Lord. We have to lay them on the altar so that he can consume it and then give us the desires of his heart. Our heart should line up with the desires of the heart of the Lord so that our kingdom work would not be for nothing. Kingdom work is an act or acts done that results in the growth of the kingdom of God. Of the kingdom of God, not our kingdom. It results in the growth of the kingdom of God. Our acts benefit the kingdom if we are spreading the good news, not our own news. If we are spreading the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ, before we can go to the masses or before we can go on missions, we must first lay aside every weight that would easily beset us. A great definition of the word beset is to attack. And when we start to make up our mind that we are going to do a work for the kingdom, or we are going to go into the hedges and the highways and we're going on missions and we're going to go to Lower Wacker, or we're going to even talk to our own family members, things start to attack us. Things start to beset us. We start to get harassed. Enemies of all different kinds start to show up. Difficulties start to surround us. And we start to say, okay, maybe this is not what I need to be doing. Maybe this work is not the work that the Lord called us to. But those personal hangup of ours, we have to lay those on the altar. We have to lay those things down. And then we have to remember what the commission is. Our work at the altar is affected by what Christ has given us the commission to do in Matthew 28. He said for us to go ye. He called us out. He called us out. And so when you get called out, think about being called out in the natural. When somebody say, oh man, you've been called out. You either step up or you back up. Christ called us to step up.
Hallelujah.
He called us to step up. This is how the altar, the things that we, the mindset that we lay aside, those things that will keep our mind in bondage. When we lay those things aside and step up and be the go ye, then things start to happen on our behalf. Because of how we respond, the Lord then responds to the sacrifice that we have made. We make a sacrifice at the altar, so the Lord responds in kind. What is the sacrifice that we make? When we make our response, when we make our sacrifice, God responds to it by enabling us. if you look at Romans 12 and 1, God enables us. He gives us grace. He enables us to do the work of the kingdom. But our sacrifice is when we present our bodies, we present the entirety of who we are.
That's it.
The entirety, not holding anything back. The Bible says that, that scripture says that we are to present our bodies as living sacrifices to be holy and acceptable. God has accepted the sacrifice. Of course, he's going to give us something in return. He gives us, he enables us, and then he gives us grace. If you look at Romans 12 and verse 3, it says that he makes his grace abound toward us. He gives us grace to do the things that we need to do. And then when we talk about our response to God accepting our offering, that should also be, if we look at John 21 and 17, the response from us should be to do the will of the Father.
Yes.
He asked Peter, he said, if you love me, and we always say it, we say it, Lord, I love you. Lord, I want to go where you say go. Lord, I want to do what you say do. And he says, all I'm asking you to do is feed my sheep.
Jesus.
Feed my sheep. Feed those who are the less fortunate. Feed those who can't feed themselves. Nourish those until they are able to be nourished on their own, until they can get the nourishment that they need on their own. So at the altar, there is sacrifice, there's redemption, there's restoration, there's a submission which established a covenant with God. The covenant that God establishes with us is not a half covenant, it's an entire covenant, it's complete. So everything we need in order to go from the altar to the alley, God has already supplied. But we have to spend time at the altar. We have to spend time in submission. At the altar, we are defined. It defines who we are and whose we are. Our altar should show love and honor for God. And when we honor God with the altar that we have prepared, he alters us. He changes us. He changes us from what the world used to see to his glory. Remember that the children of Israel never went ahead of the glory. They always followed the glory. And so that's what we do. When he changes us, we are always following. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We're always following his glory. We are following the glory. And so that way, if we are following the glory, then we're able to go to the nations. We're able to go to the hedges and the highways and the byways. We're able to go to the other countries and show the love of God, because God has already prepared us. And when we get instruction, he told us, he said that to feed the hungry and to clothe those who were naked and to take care of those, his sheep, to take care of those that are his sheep, the needy. The needy are the ones that Christ called his brothers. Thus, that reference is for us as well. We don't look at anyone and say, well, they're less than we are, because we have all been unified as one under Christ. And when we are serving those, we are serving him. So when we serve at the altar, when we lay down our idiosyncrasies and our hangups and our wants and our needs, when we lay those things down at the altar, then Christ fills us. He fills us. But if we're holding on to it, if we are holding on to that stuff that we think we really need, then Christ cannot fill us with what he cannot fill us with love, joy, peace, kindness. He can't fill us with that, because we're holding on to some things that the world has defined in us. So we have to let those things go. And when we do that, then he shapes us. He takes us and makes us his own. He keeps us under the shadow of his wings. And he shapes us and he makes us. And then he sends us out. He fills us up and then he sends us out. And then when we are sent, according to the scripture in Luke 14 and 23, that's when we can go. That scripture is so paramount, and it's in the key scriptures for you to study. But that is the scripture that enables us and helps us to be prepared to go from the altar to the alley. Amen.
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 Hallelujah. Listen, Minister Jeanette came right on in under her towel. Listen, you brought it on in and left us right at being sent. tell you, God is amazing. He doesn't, you don't even know where Apostle is going to go or what we can talk about. I want to share with everyone on the line. We are getting ready. I want to introduce to you someone. She entered into my life. I've watched her, followed her, was kind of scared of the grace and the anointing on this woman's life. She entered into my life. I walked in to preach at a church quite a few years ago, and I saw her sitting on the front row. And I'm talking about, I got scared. I said, oh Lord, Apostle Peters is here. And I said, okay, and I got to meet her. And then during a very transitional moment in my life, God allowed me to sit down. And I'm telling you, it was such an honor to actually sit with her and have coffee and just to be able to talk and glean and learn. This is truly an apostolic voice, a true sent one, one who operates in government. She is a pastor in Chicago. She is a prominent mother of Zion. She mothers many prominent pastors, bishops, elders, apostles. She's an apostle's apostle.
Amen.
Glory to God. She is one that also establishes through revelation the word of God. What I love about her is that she's not giving you fluff. She's going to give you meat. She's going to dig into it, and she's going to tell you the truth. The woman of God has traveled cities. She has gained experience teaching in many systems, and she's going to talk about it today. She's taught, trained, equipped people, and then deployed. And one of the things that's most important about why she's here today is that she doesn't just send people, but she is a sent one. So one of the things that I learned about her is that she went and did the work.
Hallelujah. Yes. Jesus Christ. Yes.
See, we don't want somebody telling us, go ye in all the nations, and they haven't left the altar. Amen. Got to be able to go beyond the walls. And I tell people all the time, and those that are new to the class, and I'm going to bring up Apostle Peters, the church is necessary. The church is our equipping, discipling place. It is likened to a gas station. You got to go get the gas, but the car is no good unless you drive off the lot. Amen? We got to take the car
right
off the lot eventually. So the church is where
that's right.
We get sharpened, we are discipled,
yes.
We can go.
Yes,
glory Lord to God. And so I want to bring to you this awesome woman of God. You know, I'm so excited to have her with her, Apostle Sharon Peters, and she's going to talk to us about let's go. Hallelujah. Bless you.
Hallelujah.
Bless you so much. Amen. Thank you so much, Elder. It's so good being on here with you guys. I have enjoyed both teachings tremendously. And it's just good to tag team and share with you all. This is really an interesting time that we find ourselves in as the church, as the ecclesia, the called out ones. I greatly enjoy what you were talking about, the Bara, the creativity, God's achievement, humanly unforeseeable things, newness, all of those things, because that's where we are right now. The old has definitely passed away, and we have sat in buildings long enough. Many people have been of the learned ones in terms of the gospel, got a good deal of the gospel. Their feet is shod with the preparation of the gospel, but yet have been dormant and not have allowed God to bring that innovation and creativity, witty inventions and things of what they can do. And there's a saying that I always use, and I kind of got it from Jesus when the guys came to him that needed to be healed of leprosy. The Bible says, as they went, they were healed. And mm-hmm. God began to speak to me one time. He says, Sharon, you'll get more as you go.
Come on.
You'll get more as you go. And I believe that we will get more momentum Amen. As the church when we go. Amen. I believe that we'll gain more souls as we go. I believe that more work will be done as we go. I believe that a greater witness will take place as we go. I think when we go, we'll do more evangelizing. I think when we go, we'll render more strength to other disciples. Paul went around a lot of places just to strengthen the disciples. Yeah. And so as apostolic people, we should be able, not just the apostle, because Ephesians 4:11 really talks about the whole essence of the fivefold ministry is to equip the saints to do the work of ministry. And this is you enlisted in the work, the building of the kingdom. God took me off of out of corporate America 17 years ago. And he spoke to me right at my desk where I was making a whole bunch of money. And he says, Sharon, I didn't call you to build corporate America. I called you to build the kingdom. And so I had to leave that place and go saved, holy, everything. But I had to leave that and enlist and begin to get into the work that God was calling me to. So I want to talk about, let's go. Let's talk about that. And I want to read and just delve into just a few scriptures before I get into some things, some other things that I want to present and to say, and hopefully I'll help you and light the fire under you, the importance of going. Matthew 20:4, we hear Jesus saying, go ye also. If I was in my church, I would tell you to underline that word also. Go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right, I will give you. And they went their way. Now here, some of you need to go, a great host of you need to go so that you can do some work. So he says, go ye also in the vineyard, go into the field, go, come out of the house, go and do some work. And there are a lot of people that are sitting in the church and you are comfortable with doing the work in the house. Oh, I'm a usher, I'm a deacon, I'm a this, I'm a that, whatever. Mm. But there is work in the vineyard. And if you go and do that work, I will give you what is right, okay? So that is a goal, go and do some work. Matthew 21:2, Jesus said, go into the village, said they, he told them to go into the village. Now he sent his disciples, go into the village and find an ass tied and a coat. And he says, I want you to go into the village. I want to give a premise from this, and I want you to see this. He says, go in the village and I want you to find this ass, and this ass and this coat is tied up. I want you to loose them and bring them to me. Jesus. And we have keys of the kingdom when we have the ability to loose and to bind.
Yes.
And so he said, I'm sending you to loose this animal because I have need of this animal. I need to ride into Jerusalem on something. Would you believe that God wants us to go? The Lord wants us to go and to rescue and to get folks delivered. So some of the times that I went into places where God was sending me was not very popular places, but it was to go and loose an ass. Can we say that? Go and loose something that is tied up. Go and loose something that is bound. You have the ability to go and bring deliverance. I hear people say all the time, I have a deliverance ministry. I have a deliverance ministry. But you want all the deliverance to take place in the church. I have gotten people delivered in my living room on the floor. I've gotten people delivered by going to their house. I've gotten people delivered in a crack house. I've gotten people delivered by going with the intention of loosing them.
Yes.
And so when you go, I'm trying to get to this point where, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? Am I equipped to go and to do these things? What has God equipped me to go and do? What kind of work can I go and do? All right. You know, you get up every morning and your children say, well, before COVID, your children say, Mom, where are you going? You say, I'm going to work.
Come on.
Okay. And so you're used to going to work in terms of a job, but where do you go and work for the kingdom? Where do you go to work? Where can you say, this is my work that I'm going to do? You know, I don't care where it is, but where do you go as a kingdom ambassador to do some work for the kingdom?
Jesus.
Matthew 22:9, and we've spoke about this. He says, go ye therefore in the highways, and as many as you find, be it to the marriage. And so then there's a part of us where we should go looking for the lost.
Glory.
We should go looking, watch this. We should go looking for the ones that think they not worthy enough to come. Yeah. We should go looking for the ones, because if you understand the premise of this scripture, these people, there were people that were called. This parable Jesus mentioned, there were people that were called, but they too busy to come. I got, you know, I got business, I got things to do. I ain't got no time to come to this marriage. So the man said, well, just go into the highways. Just go find people and invite them to come. The ones that don't think that they're worthy to come. And so going and coming goes together. Yes. When we go and we cause people to come, Jesus even said, come unto me. And we've got to go and let people know, yes, you are worthy enough to come unto him, those that are heavy laden and burdened. You know what I'm saying? He's looking to give you rest. So I'm looking for some people to come. So we have to go to help them come. Have you ever helped somebody come to Jesus? No, they would sing the song, come to Jesus, come to Jesus. Have you helped somebody come? There are some people that need help coming. So they're lost. I don't even know how to get to Jesus. I don't even know about this thing. I heard a person one time, and it was the saddest thing I had ever heard in my life. And it was a preacher. And a preacher's son asked him. He said, Daddy, the preacher was telling me the story. He said, his son said, Daddy, I think I want to come to the Lord. How do I come? This is his son. How do I come to the Lord? He said, come to church.
Help us today.
I cringe. Oh my God. Is that how we help people come to Jesus?
Jesus.
It's great to invite, you know, you can have your friends and family day, all the stuff that we have done, you know, for whatever reason. But what if it's that moment and you're in that place and you were sent, you were going another direction. You weren't going to go straight home, but God had you stop in the nursing home for something to see, and somebody is laying there. Come. What if that's the opportunity? Maybe that's why you went there, to help somebody come to the Lord. But if we have only used the building as our place of come, didn't say come to the building. Jesus said, come unto me.
Yes, Lord.
Come unto me. So sometimes we're going to help someone figure out how to come to him. I've had wonderful opportunities in helping people come. Hospitals, wherever, in houses, all kind of people, helping people come to Jesus, because don't take it for granted that everybody knows how to come. That's why we have to go. Yeah. And so finally, before I go into a presentation and talk a little bit more about the places I've gone and why I've gone there and all of that, Mark 1:37-38, it says this about Jesus. When his disciples had found him, they said unto him, all men seek for thee. And said unto them, Jesus said unto them, then let us go. He said, let us go into the next town that I may preach there also. There's that word also. He says, for therefore came I forth. Christian Standard Bible said, this is why I've come. So let's go. Let's go. And so you've got to understand, you're saved and you're living for God. And you know where you will go. You know where you're going to spend eternity. Now, is it just about you and just everything you can get and all of that? And you put no foot movement. When the Bible says in him we live and then we move and have our being. But if there's no movement, one of the reasons why the church was persecuted was to get some movement in the first church. It created movement for the church. It caused the church to get going all kind of different places. And so Jesus' attitude, Jesus was not stagnant. Number one, somebody can write that down. Jesus was not stagnant. Number two, Jesus was not immobile. Number three, Jesus moved here and he moved there. Likewise, we must do the same thing. Jesus, he moved purposely. He said, it needs be that I go to Samaria. This woman is confused. She knows that the Jews don't want to really be bothered with them. She's got questions about worship. I need to clarify. I need to give her a prophetic word. I need to release a prophetic word. Then I need to put her to work and have her drop them water pots and go bring them men over here so that we can run a 3-day revival over here in Samaria. Yes. So Jesus moved with purpose. I got to get to Samaria. Where is it that you're supposed to go? Where is it that you have that burning, that necessity of movement? I got to go here. I got to go here. I've got to get there. I've got to get there. I knew that last summer, I think around this time, I was like, I know I got to get to the West Coast. I got to get to the West Coast. I got to do some things. The moment I agreed about I got to get to the West Coast, all kind of doors just began to open up. Can you come over here, Apostle? Can you come here? Mm-hmm. Can you do this? Can you help me do that? I agreed to go.
Yes, Lord.
Do you agree to go? Mm-hmm. It must be an agreement to go. And then you've got to know why you're going. Am I going to sow seeds? Am I going to water? Am I going to work? Am I going to witness? Am I going to strengthen? Am I going looking for somebody that's lost? Am I going to bring deliverance? Am I going to bring healing? Am I going to support? Am I to go to evangelize? Am I going to reach out? Am I going to serve? Am I to go with something in my hand? What am I to go for? What am I to go for? And stop saying I was sent on assignment. Tell it, define it. Define the assignment, because you make me nervous. If you just say that, I was sent here on assignment. Mm. What's the assignment? I don't know. I'm nervous already because who undertakes an assignment and don't know what it is?
Jesus.
And so what are you going? What are you going to bring impact? What are you going to do? When Jesus ascended, and this is the last scripture that I want to bring out. When Jesus ascended in Mark 16, the Bible says that the disciples went forth. He had walked with them. He had trained them. He had equipped them. He had taught them how to pray. He had answered their questions. He had rebuked them. He had reproved them. And the Bible said he dealt even with their hearts being troubled about him leaving. And the Bible says when he ascended, the Bible said the disciples went forth in Mark 16 and 20. It said they went forth. It said they was preaching everywhere.
Yes.
Now you say, I'm not a preacher, but I said you can go for a whole lot of other reasons.
That's it.
We all, according to Acts 1, we all should be filled. If we're the church, we should be filled with the Spirit. And that alone should make us a witness. And those cloven tongues of fire should give us a boldness to be able to go and to say and to do. So you may not be the preacher. And you don't have to be the preacher per se, but you should be running with the gospel.
Yes.
You should be running with some good news. And so you should have some good news to run with and to go. The Bible says, Mark 16 and 20, it said the disciples went forth. That means they went. They went to, they was going. It says they was preaching everywhere. And here's the part I love. It says the Lord was working with them.
Yes.
The Lord was working with them, confirming the word with signs.
Yes, with Lord. Signs.
You don't see no signs because you ain't going nowhere. You don't see no signs because you're not carrying the word. See, they carried the word. And God was working with them. And it's a wonderful thing. I have gone to a lot of places. I have done a lot of work. I've gone to places that was not necessarily of interest of the church to go per se, not necessarily interest. I've gone to give hope to whores. Yeah, I said it. Up on the west side, Madison in California, I would raise up apostolic teams to go with me. We're going. We're going to do this church service here, and we're dispatching, and we're getting out of this building, and we're going wherever the Lord has said to me to send me. And there was always details of what I am supposed to do. And I did not go unequipped, neither did I go unaccompanied. Okay? Yeah. Jesus was sending them out two by two. And so mm-hmm. I've done things where I went to up on Madison in California. You probably passed the building, don't even know it. But it's a place in there where prostitutes that are drug addicts are mandated to go for rehabilitation. Someone asked me and said, would you go and do spiritual, they call it spiritual enrichment, she said, you know. They'll change the words up on you. I'm good. And to women, I said, sure. I work with women all the time. I have women's ministry. Been working with women for 20 years. She said, well, these are women of the night. I said, okay. And so I took an intercessor. And I'm telling you, it was heartbreaking to hear a woman say to me, thank you for coming, because the church usually don't want to come to us.
Jesus.
Don't usually want to come to us. So we always want to bring people into the building. And the build and that has its place. But y'all gotta know everybody ain't gonna come. Compel them to come. Mm-mm. And some of the compelling is when you go where they are. I've been in crack houses where they was just, you know, I've sent my intercessors and ministers into crack houses. You know, Jesus sent people out there, he said, you're going to tread upon serpents.
Come on.
But it's not going to harm you. And so, you know, we're back. We got apostolic authority. And we go where God is leading us to go. I love to get outside of the church building. I love to get outside of the building and to do a lot of things. Well, let's put up the presentation. Let's talk about some of the things on the slide, and I'll just talk about some of the things we're accustomed to seeing, some of the things we're not necessarily accustomed to seeing.
All right, hold on, here we go. And we'll start the slideshow, and here we go.
Pass it. Amen.
You tell me when to click, and I'll go.
Okay, so you can go ahead and click to the first one. So sometimes when I go into the marketplace, I go into places, I do business. Jesus said, do business, you know, occupy, do business. And so sometimes I go as kingdom, a kingdom representative, and I do business in hotels. I do business in corporate settings. I do business. So that means that I gotta talk to people that are not necessarily used to talking to the church, not used to the sound of the church, not used to the gathering. I go to those places and then I summons other people, other women to come. And so here's a place right here. Look at the people and to bring people together. I have a great ability to connect people and bring people together. So look at all of these people. Look at all of these women. They're summoned. This is not in the church. My church is not a huge mega church. It's mega in power, but I don't have mega in numbers. But look what happens when I go into this place and I summons the people to come. And so I summons people a lot to come to venues like this. I'll go into that venue, then I'll summons, though. I'll walk on it. I take dominion and territory, and I get the favor of God, and they give me things, and the provisions is made, and all of that. Then when all things are ready, then I summons people. There are people that come from all different states and different things like that to have an experience and an encounter with God that they don't get, watch this, in the building.
Woo.
Next, you can take us to the next one. And so this is what we're typical. This is what we're accustomed to. Preachers ministering from the pulpit. However, the next slide. However, sometimes I go on college campuses and I share with women there. This is where education is. This is where people are learning. This is where knowledge is. This is where skills are. This is where, but that's a whole nother group. And I adjust myself accordingly. I got the same Jesus, the same gospel, but as Elder said, you know, we become innovative with the things that we do. Mm-hmm. God gives us a methodology. You know, the message doesn't change, but our methodology, we've seen that with COVID, our methodology had to change. So I take a different methodology. I may change the way I dress a little bit. You know, I might've got in trouble somewhere in the church building and some other church buildings preaching like that, but not on the college campus.
There you go.
So you understand? Still saved, mm-hmm. still holy, still, you understand? Notice Amen. There's no pulpit. No pulpit, yes. right? Mm-hmm. No pulpit. And mic in hand and tablet, you know, in hand. And there we go for it. So I go that way. Sometimes I've done things where I went into a corporate setting and I was asked to minister on a particular subject. Take me back a little bit. Take me back if you can. Go back to the college setting. And so, okay, go one more. Okay, so we're going to stay right there a minute. And so, and I'm going to talk about that. And I already kind of talked about that. But I went into a corporate setting where it was about 50 social workers. Someone invited me. And right before, there were other presenters and they were presenting anything that was in line that we could call spiritual. And mm-hmm. so when it came up time for me, the person that invited me who was a Christian, she said, I just want to let you know that we do have this is corporate now, this wasn't church. This wasn't in the church building. She said, we do have a transvestite that is going to come before you. Do you have a problem? I said, I don't have a problem. I'm there to do what I'm going to do. He going to do what he going to, she or whatever going to do what they going to do. And so the transvestite came before me and who was a social worker. And while I was talking about self-care in the way that I could to make it spiritual, I looked at the transvestite or the transsexual, let me get it right. And he had tears in his eyes. Mm. He had tears in his eyes. So we can't, when we go to these different places, we've got to know who we are, know who we serve. Do know that you're going to walk in territories that don't necessarily believe what you believe, have not even been given an opportunity to believe. And you've got to know what you know and believe what you believe and trust what you trust in and do what God has sent you there. I was clear what I was sent to do. And I did it. And there were many people after I got done. Guess what they asked me? Where's your church?
Come on.
Where's your church? How long you been pastoring? And things like that. So bring it up closer, something. And so here I talked about going to the West Coast. I call those saunters, going to different places that God has sent me, taking new territory, breaking ground. It was dry out there in the West Coast. It was tough for some of the pastors out there. Need an apostle to come and tread, help us tread so that we can come on through here. Mm-hmm. The next one. And so then sometimes I go to beget sons and daughter. This young man, I begot him in the neighborhood. I'm an urban pastor, have been an urban pastor all my life, pastored in areas like West Pullman, Roseland, some of the toughest, they call it the Wow Wow Hundreds, I'm in Pullman now. And this young man, we would go in the community And I begat this young man. And when we moved, this young man, he Googled and he found me because he got saved under me. Yeah. And he Googled me. He said, I went back to where you were and you were gone. And he Googled me and he found me. And this man got saved because we were out there in the community. I've taken prostitutes in the neighborhood and let them work for me.
Yes.
You know, take them off the street. Let me pay you and I'll work mm-hmm. for you. And then they get saved. You understand? So mm-hmm. it is something to go. Let's see, is there a next one? Yeah. So last year we decided to just get out of the building and let's just have church in the park. Let's just get a tent and let's have a church in the park. We don't know who's going to come, but let's just go preach in the park. And let's do that. We put a tent and people came. And here is one of our youth pastor, and she's actually ministering to one of the youth that came. And the little girl is telling her about what she knows about Jesus. And Pastor Green is breaking down to her what she, you know, helping her with Jesus. So we go, I build teams and take people to the street. We take it to the street. All right. And the next one, and let's see what the next one.
That's the last one.
Okay, that's the last one. Mm-hmm. So the whole premise in what I'm talking about is let's go, church. God has set this thing up. You're really going to be dormant if you don't go. You're going to be dormant. You're going to be limited in what you do. Many of you have giftings mm-hmm. and skills mm-hmm. and abilities and capabilities that God has given you. Take it out. Do know that a lot of even your natural skills and talents are transferable for the kingdom. And you can go with those things and you can make a difference. I am dedicated as a sent one with a special message, unfolding mysteries, bringing forth revelation, those things. But I will hit the pavement. I will hit the pavement. If I don't preach in a church, I'm good, because before I ever, and this is my last statement, before I ever preached in a church, didn't even know that I was a preacher, somebody told me, you're a bootleg preacher. I said, why am I a bootleg preacher? They said, because you haven't been ordained and you haven't been licensed. I said, but I ain't preaching in nobody's pulpit. Do I need a license to preach in the beauty shop? Did I need a license to stop an abortion on the bus?
Jesus.
Because I decided to witness and talk to a woman. Did I need a license to preach to a woman and cause her to say, you know, I don't want a shack no more? Did I need a license to
read
and witness? And so I did this a long time before I got ordained and before I got licensed and before I got credentials and before anybody called me pastor or evangelist or apostle. I did a lot of the things that I did outside of the building. Mm-hmm. So I love the building. I love the church building, but it's a dying mm-hmm. world out there. And I believe in just talking to people and being a living epistle. So everywhere I go, I can be a witness for Christ. I can demonstrate him and my love for people and compassion to people, and just bringing love to our communities and different things like that. I just believe that you don't have to have a license. You don't have to have paperwork. You don't have to have those things. But if you got the gospel of Jesus Christ, you've got some good news, and you can go and run with that. Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Yeah. Glory to God. Thank you.
Amen.
Oh my God. And I love that today we have on the line an apostle. See, we have this mindset, and some of us have been indoctrinated with the mindset of evangelism isn't my grace. That's not my grace. So that's what the evangelists do. I'm a prophet. I'm a pastor. See, God has told us, you got to go.
He said, do the work of an evangelist. And he was speaking not just to an evangelist. He is calling all of us to use those natural given gifts in this season with the things that are going on with COVID. And you're not going to get to come and just lay hands on everybody that you laid hands on last week at the altar.
No.
Come on. Nope. You can't go and spit on everybody's face anymore.
Amen.
You need to have the power of the living God moving through you.
Yes.
When you walk through the grocery store, someone understands the glory of God is resting on your life, and they are compelled to come to the Christ that is on the inside of you. Apostle said it. There are some natural gifts that are inside of you. I want to share. I just want to say thank you. Oh my goodness, because you just laid it out. She laid it out, and she's making sure that we have a clear understanding that God is telling all of us, let's go. The season that we are in, the way that the state of the world, and this is not just in the United States. Listen, our friends over in Guyana, they are dealing with the same thing. They are decreeing and declaring over the nation of South America. I have friends, I have family in Cartagena, South America. They are decreeing and declaring that we will go. One of the things that they are wanting training on is to be able to pick up innovative and creative ways of dispensing the glory of God, dispensing the good news. She just gave us some awesome examples of ways of sharing and going to the places that no one else wants to go. The homeless people on Lower Wacker told us, listen, we don't always just want to sit through sermon after sermon after sermon. Come on, can you just come down here, pray for us, feed, give us some food, give us some resources. This is
what
we are needing, solutions. Come on, you all, Bara, creativity is providing solution. Get in the secret place and begin to ask the Father to reveal to you what the solution is. When you get that heart, like Apostle said, to go, God will give you instruction. Hallelujah. He's never going to send us out without some instruction in his word. Go here, do this, say this, connect with. Let me tell you, I'm so grateful because the Lord divinely allied me with Apostle Peter's in a season when God was telling me, I need you to go. Do you understand? I didn't know anything about, he launched a ministry called Zion Movement, which was to compel the worshipers, Judah, to go first. We did 2 years of Zion Movement, but if I had not met her and I had not heard the things that she was doing, I would have thought, well, as a prophet, am I supposed to be doing this kind of work? Because, you know, I had to hear. Listen, God wants all of us to go. So there's people on the line here. You're saying, well, I'm not an evangelist, or I'm not an apostle, I'm not an elder, I don't have a title. Like she said, God has given you a natural given gift on your job. Let me tell you, there are systems right now in the midst of this COVID crisis where you can govern. There are managers now starting in corporate America, something called well-being calls. Do you know that the open now?
Yes.
Open because of the stress and the strain, not just of COVID, but what's going on in society with societal justices. There is an open door now to deal with social emotional needs. And you know what? Come on, borrow creativity. Let's just make it social spiritual needs. That's what we're going to do. We're going to start saying, okay, under the premise of social emotional needs, we're going to begin to say where they say there's health coaching for employees and their spouses now. Those of us that know how to counsel some marriages in the world can now begin to give people some health for their marriages, for their covenants. Hallelujah. There are some things in corporate America that says they're going to start providing weekly well-being communications and boosting and morale boosting activities. Right? The world is saying we're going to call it morale boosting activities. We're going to provide some worship at lunchtime. We're going to provide some things. We're going to provide some encouragement. We're going to send some thought thinking of you emails. We're going to think about inspirational cards, because that is how the kingdom begins to turn the kingdoms of this world into the kingdom of our Lord. Listen, they are a corporate America is now saying you can have live meditation sessions and activity breaks. Do y'all hear this? You can have some people are going to go and have yoga at lunch, but the kingdom is going to say, hey, y'all, we getting ready to start praying. Y'all want to meet And lunchtime, we're going to pray. And we ain't going to be screaming and hollering and pushing people down. We're going to actually give some prayer requests. Hey, what do you need to pray for? Mm-hmm. What can we pray for you? And let's be consistent in it. And let's be diligent and honest. We're going to pray. We're going to intercede. We're going to enter into the courts of heaven and begin to mediate on behalf of people who have never had an advocate before. Ooh, come on, y'all. We need to do this. Look, corporate America and societal norms now are saying they're going to have resiliency and stress management activities. Resilient. We're going to make you resilient because we want you to come to work. We know in the midst of COVID, a lot of people don't want to come to work. We're going to provide resiliency and stress management activities. So listen, kingdom, governors,
yes,
glory, it's time for us to start saying, well, during my resiliency activity, I want to play a little worship. I want to have some exercise. I want to do some art therapy. I want to start painting what the Lord is saying while the music's playing. I want to start bringing some things that will establish peace and shalom in the office. Listen, in our families, God has given us some ability to go from the highways to the byways to the uttermost parts of the earth and beyond. We can do it. We have to tap into God's bara, creativity, his innovation. And remember, it is not just so we can say, I'm creative. I'm a creative. I'm a dancer. I'm a singer. No, you're providing solutions. You're providing something that has never been seen before. You're providing something that is beyond man's ability. Come on, it's miraculous. It's supernatural. And it is transformational. Woo, Lord Jesus. This is where we're going in this season. When she taught, let's go, and let's, and I'm going to bring this up, and then we're going to close out. Let me give some quick examples. She talked about some great, oh my God, because some of you on the line saying, well, I can't go to the colleges. Nobody's invited me to go. Well, I got some things that you can do. You can do if you haven't, you may not be called necessarily to speak to large crowds, but you can go in a grocery store. Or how about this? You may have been a part of a worship and creative department. I know you're on the line and you're saying, well, now I was on the drama team and we don't have no place to do drama. Oh, you can do it in the parks. You can do pop-up skits. You can do all kinds of things that will allow people to hear and see the word of God. I'm gonna go there and then we're gonna come out innovative formats, innovation. Come on, somebody. We're gonna go in. Hold on 1 second. We're gonna share this screen once again. This is me learning how to use a share screen. Glory to God. Here we go. All right. Sharing the screen. And we're going to hit this real quick and get on out of here. Innovative formats and untapped venues. Apostle Peter's talked about untapped venues. What is that? That means places that nobody wants to go, where the prostitutes are, the rehabilitation centers. Come on, somebody. The places where they are recovering addicts, where there are people. Listen, we went for 2 years to California Gardens. That place needs people to come with the good news. They have a whole fourth floor filled with persons that are bound in their minds. But the glory of God can shift everything. Uh-huh. Do you hear me? They need some people who are willing to say, I can go. I will go. I may not be able to preach, but I can go down there and I can sing a couple of songs. And I'm telling you, the glory of God will shift the minds of God's people. There are some untapped venues in Chicago, in the state where you're living, in Georgetown. There are untapped places where the glory has not tapped on the door. And God is saying, in this season, I need you to go. So we're going to move forward in this. God wants us to follow his map. Listen, your feet are beautiful. They bring the good news. They proclaim peace. They bring good tidings. They say, God, our God reigns. So wherever your feet go, like she said, come on, let's go. Your feet should bring good truth. Wherever you are in the grocery store, listen, your feet bring glad tidings. Your feet should speak. And I'm not talking about just the dancers. I know everybody's saying, well, Jackie, you're a dancer. Yes. Everybody on this line, your feet should speak. Glory to God. We should be looking for where we can go. You can go with the Ministry of Helps. Come on. Somebody might say, well, I don't necessarily cook, but you can serve. Come on. There are soup kitchens. Mm-hmm. places where you can go and you can encourage somebody with a smile. You can just, by handing them a plate, you can bless them. Pastor Tracy Lee had, for the last 2 years, the warmest warming center in Chicago. She was bringing homeless people into the church. And guess what? While they were there, they were getting haircuts, massages, and then the worshipers, that's what you see over here, were going and we were worshiping. We were releasing the glory of God just like it was church. I mean, they were, you see here people who we gave them flags. Listen, you can be a worshiper. Listen, this woman of God had never, she said she never even wanted to think about coming to church. Until she got that flag, that woman began to worship like she had never worshiped before. Untapped venues, education. This is a high school where I was sent to go, and they said they had never taught dance before, praise dance. I spent 3 days with these girls, and I'm telling you, four of them got saved from the class because they wanted to know more about Jesus. All I was doing was teaching them how to exalt him through movement. You can do this, and education is burning for it. Of course, now we can't come into the classroom in a lot of places, but there are students in places where they're coming together and they need the good news, untapped venues. Here, AV, art and drama, these are innovative formats that, guess what? You don't have to have 100 people in the room to present the gospel. You can do a live stream with an illustration of the word. You can paint pictures and begin to talk about a painting is therapeutic. This woman right here is actually in school for art therapy. She is learning how to encourage and strengthen people in their inner man, in their souls and in their spirits through releasing through art. This is somebody sitting with sound and AV. There are all kinds of innovative formats that God wants to give us when we ask him, so that the good news can go. And it can go further than where you are, because it can go through the media. Hallelujah. Here we go, the next slide, and we're almost done. Using illustrations of the word, and we can take what was inside the church outside. We can take it not just outside, as in outside in the park or outside on the street, but you can film things and record it and then release it on social media, and people come to know who Christ is. We can still use our graces and our gifts and our natural gifts, like Apostle mentioned, to bring God to his people. The ones that he loves, the ones that would never come into the church, might watch a play. Come on, somebody. They just might see you in a movie that God told you to produce. They might hear the word through something that you have written. Some of y'all are sitting on this line with plays that you wrote years ago that would tell somebody of your testimony and tell somebody how good God is. And it don't have to be churchy and religious, but it's got to have truth in it. And God will use that writing to bring someone to him. Untapped venues, illustrations of the word. And then for those who are saying the nations, I'm called to the nation. Let me tell you something. Listen, God will call you to the nation when you have been transformed first. Because he's not going to let you go and transform another land and your heart hasn't been regenerated, or your purpose is so that you can say, I'm now apostolic because I've put my feet on different land and I'm doing some apostolic work. But there is no traceable evidence that change has come. See, when you go and you go with the good news, like Apostle said, we should be able to see miracles, signs, and wonders. Something's going to show up when God is going through you. This is me in South America. I love Cartagena. It's my other home. These are some of my family there. God has blessed me to go to Italy. And I'm going to tell you, there was a difference when I went with understanding and when I went to Italy not knowing power of moving into another land. You have to get yourself transformed by the word, by the truth, and by your intents. God said, then I may call you beyond the highways and the byways. And then I want to tell you guys this last thing. While you're working, the leaders that are on this line, pastors, the bishops, the apostles, it's okay to bless and honor those that you co-labor with, those that go with you. Come on.
Yes.
Bless and honor the people. This is a basic Mary's mission head. We just wanted to bless the people that were going to California Gardens with us, that were going to the highways and the byways, that would go to the places nobody else. We just had a time. Listen, we know that God's reward is greater than anything we could do. We are honoring those that we labor with. We want to honor them and tell them we appreciate you. We love you. We want to encourage you. So I implore you, if you're working on a team, maybe you don't meet with your team anymore because the church doors, you know, have not allowed you to come in. It's okay to send a card and just tell them, I want to thank you for the work that you've done. I want to say I honor you, and I want to recognize that you spent some years doing this work that nobody else sees. Come on, it's all right to bless and honor those that you co-labor with. Am I right, Jeanette? I just yes, love
you're
love
right.
This mission. That's a beautiful team. And then I mentioned this
amen.
In
my amen.
Classes, we need divine alliances. Persons that we have connected with, Apostle Sharon Peters, I am allying with. This is somebody I need to be connected to, okay? Who carries spiritual and natural authority in a region so that they can say you've gone, maybe you've been sent to the north side or you've been sent to a certain area in your city. You want to connect with someone that will continue the work that you were released and that you were assigned to do. The assignment that you had in worship, in prayer, in intercession, in mapping, you want to connect with pastors, intercessors, prophets, and evangelists. And how about this, you all? Board members, village trustees, business owners, come on, and all the creative arts servants. You want to connect with them so the work continues. The work continues. I wanted to share that with you guys. We have been really blessed to have you all on the line for the last 4 weeks. I pray that this class, this module one, helped to stir and to light the fire. I know listening to Apostle just lit my fire even more, that I want to get that instruction. I want to get, Lord, specifically, what is the assignment? And yes, how sir. Do you want me to go? And I'm telling you all today, we are preparing. I love what she said. Jesus was not stagnant. And I know you're going to say, well, Jackie, you a dancer. You just love movement. Yes, I do. This is called Prepare for End Time Movement. We are a body, the body of Christ. We carry the word, which is quick. Come on, somebody. It is alive. It's moving. So if you're sitting still, you must not have the word in you, because the word is going to make you good. People say, Jackie, always moving. Yes, because I love a word. I'm eating it. I'm drinking. I'm hungry and thirsting for righteousness. And it's keeping me alive. Glory to God. Yes. So we on this line should be getting stirred through these classes. Go back, listen to the first week. Listen to it. Maybe you got to replay it. Maybe some of you all didn't take the time to do your homework, but now you got some time. Go back and apply the concepts and apply. We're going to be sending outlines from this week, even from the teaching that myself, Minister Jeanette, and Apostle did. We're going to be sending the presentation. We want you to go back over it and remember that God is telling you, prepare and then go. Prepare and then go. Don't sit and say, well, I'm still waiting for, you know, somebody to release me. God has already released you. When he birthed you and put you in your mother's womb, and then he birthed you into the kingdom, he released you to be a witness unto him and to go into the uttermost parts of the earth. Come on, and to teach them all that you've observed. You're released. You're released. And we are excited to say that in November, we're believing God that we will have module two. Module two of Prepare for End Time Movement will be dealing with prophesying to a dying world, because a lot of people have the mindset that the prophet is supposed to be in the church. We don't go nowhere. We just stand at the altar and thus saith the Lord. But we're going to teach about prophesying to a dying world. We're going to deal with deliverance and what that really is. So we get out of our mind that it's all about how hard you could push somebody down. It's going to be about really understanding the casting out of demons and moving with the word of truth in you. God, Jesus, we're going to be dealing with feast times and understanding God's set appointed times to go. Glory to God, when God is looking for you to do a heart search, a circumcision, some repentance, and getting yourself prepared to move, we're going to have some exciting new things that once you have finally said yes, and like Apostle said, I'm ready to go. Once you get out there, how to make sure that you are ready to deal with when you go to the places mm-hmm. where the prostitutes are, and you're met with some things that you have never seen before because you're moving in borrowing newness. Come on, I can attest. When we got down to Lower Wacker, Jacqueline Saunders had never seen some things, but God had to prepare us. And so in module 2, we'll be dealing with some of those things. I just thank God for all of you. If you have any questions, our administrators are on now. So if you want to send the questions in for Apostle, for Minister Jeanette and myself, I'm looking and I'm waiting for my administrator to tell me if we have any questions. We can always answer them via email. We just want to say thank you. Also, on tomorrow, you guys will receive evaluations. Tomorrow morning, and probably they may even go out tonight, the evaluations for this class. We want your feedback. We want to know what kind of things that you really enjoyed and what kind of things we could have done better. We're excited that this was a pioneering class for Miriam's Mission. And so we're thankful for every person that participated. I want to say thank you to Minister Consuela Gaines, Shantae Cook. I want to say thank you to Minister Keena Arnold and Jocelyn Billheimer. I want to say thank you to Pastor Lisa Harris and Aaliyah Johnson. And of course, Minister Jeanette, who helped me in this endeavor, and Apostle Sharon Peters. Rough. Thank you. She rough, y'all. She's rough. She came with it. I'm so grateful for you all forming a strong team each and every Monday that bless God's people. We're going to pray now as we leave out. I don't see anything from my administrators as questions, but if you have them, again, you all have my email for those that are registered. Thank you for all of the guests that joined on today. Y'all, let's go. Let's go. How about this, Apostle? It's past time, isn't it?
Past time.
Someone said to me, oh, yeah, Jackie, the church has left the building. I said, man, you know, some of us left a long time ago. come on out, because we need your help. We need the men. We got to pray. Listen, y'all, pray. Next time we do classes like this, it's not just women registered. We have 2 men. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
The men to get themselves prepared and ready.
Yes.
Leaders, y'all pray for the pastors that haven't left the building in years. They forgot. They started out on the streets. God saved started pastoring and forgot to go back out. We got to pray for them, you all. So Minister Jeanette, I'm going to ask you to close us in prayer and thank you again. Love y'all. Go ahead, Minister.
Amen. Okay. Father, we thank you for this time, Lord God. We thank you for this time of impartation, Father. We thank you, Lord God, that you have called us to go ye, that we can hit the street, Lord God, back, that we will no longer, Lord God, think of those things that would so easily beset us, Father, but we would press toward the mark of the higher calling that is found only in you, Lord God. Father, we ask, our heart desire, Father, is for you to lead and guide us to those, Lord God, that you would desire for us to witness to. Lead us, Lord God, to those that need to be fed, those that need to be watered, those that need to be sown into, oh Father. And God, because you have given us this mission, Father, because you have given us this mandate, Lord God, we don't take lightly, Lord God, the instructions that you give us. So we will always come back to you, oh Father. We will seek first your kingdom, oh Father, and knowing all other things that we desire and all other things that we need will be added, oh God. Father, we thank you for each ear that heard, Lord God, the words that went forth on these last 4 weeks. We thank you, Lord God, for the hearts of those that were open to receive the seeds that were sown, oh Father. And Father, as we gird up and as we build up each other, oh Father, as we encourage each other in you, oh God, help us to take this word that is in us. Help us to take everything, hallelujah, Jesus, that you have poured into us. Help us to take it out, Lord God, to a dying world, that they may ask, what must I do to be saved? Help us to be ready, Lord God. Oh God, help us to be ready, Lord God, to pour out, to water, Lord God. Help us, Lord God, God, to be ready, Lord God, to upkeep, Lord God, the people, the sheep, Lord God, that you have given us to feed, Father. God, we thank you for Elder Jackie. We thank you for Apostle Sharon, Father. We thank you for everything, Lord God, that was put out on this day, Lord God. Let it not fall on fallow ground, oh God, but let it fall on the soft folds of our hearts, oh Father, so that everything, Lord God, that we have captured, oh Father, we will be able to again pull it up because your word has been written on our hearts, oh God. We thank you now. Hallelujah, Jesus. We thank you now, Lord God, for your word that is truth. We thank you now, Lord God, for your word that is sharper than any two-edged sword. We thank you now, Lord God, that your word will accomplish what you sent it out to accomplish. We thank you now, Lord God. Oh God, that every place that our foot tread, that is the territory that you will give us. We thank you now, Lord God. And we speak blessings over every ministry that is associated with this class. We speak Goshen over them, oh Father. God, we thank you for creativity. Oh, we thank you that you have created us in your image. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. We thank you now, God. We expect greater, Father. For greater are you that's in us than he that's in the world. We expect greater, Lord God. Our expectation is in you, Father. Our hope is in you, Lord God. Our trust is in you, Father, that there will be no repercussions, oh God, there will be no backlash, oh God, that everything that went out on today, Lord God, will hit the mark of where you have aimed it to hit, and we give you glory for it, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. For end time movement, let's go loose the ass. Let's people go. Y'all be blessed. Have a wonderful evening, and we will see you soon. God bless you.
Yes. God bless you.
Hallelujah. In this live, God bless you guys.